Hello everyone, welcome to Basket News. I'm the host Donatas Urbonas, and today we're visiting Milan before the very important, very nice, very high quality game Barcelona-Milan. We're visiting Milan and we have a guest, FC Barcelona head coach Sarunas Jasikevicius. Hello Sarunas.
Hi.
Sarunas, I read your book on my flight to Milan, and once again, I understood that you're obsessed of winning, and your book is also is called, the title of the book is "It's Not Enough Only to Win the Game." Although you mentioned that for you, the most beautiful thing is to win games. The victory is the best. But you said it as a former player, more or less, as a fresh assistant coach of Zalgiris Kaunas.
Yes.
After a few years being the head coach, how do you feel about your statements, and do you enjoy something else besides victory right now?
No. I mean, that's the basic thing, you know. That's the thing that gives you calmness in this job. That's the thing that gives you, you know, a sense of joy for a moment. But then you have to, as a coach especially, I think you have to, first of all, worry about the process. First of all, I think you have to worry about improving. It's very important to come to the key moments of the season in good shape. It's very important to develop young players. It's a lot of stuff. Yes, so winning at some point has to be not the main thing. You know, even though, like I said, it's, you go home very happy when you win. But if you win and you improved, you felt somebody who was struggling played better, that he's taking steps, that we're taking steps as a team. That's probably the ultimate at this point of the season.
And talking about the last season, for example, when Michael Jordan lost his NBA Finals against Detroit Pistons.
He never lost the Finals.
Eastern Conference Finals. Yeah, sorry, my bad. The next day he hit the gym and he was building muscle, you know, to not to be beaten again by, yes, Detroit Pistons bad boys. When you lost the EuroLeague final last year, when you were sitting on the bench watching Efes players celebrating, what were you thinking about, you know, how you need to improve your team, your roster, yourself maybe, in order to beat this unbelievable team? We have to be honest. Yeah. This Anadolu Efes is a beast.
Yeah, well, we didn't have time to think about improving yourself. We don't have time to do, I mean, it was a very sad moment, but in this case, in ACB, in 48 hours, we had already the first game of the playoffs. So we lost to Efes on Sunday night. Tuesday night, we already played best of three against Juventud. If you lose the first one, then you go second one in Badalona with the chances of fighting for your season. So at this point, it was, you know, just sadness for the loss, but you know, you have to think that in 3 weeks you finish the season and you have the whole summer to think about what you can do and what you cannot do and how to improve yourself, like you said, and so on. At this point it was just surviving the end of the season, because we knew we had a great chance of winning a second title. We knew we had a great chance of winning ACB that we haven't done in a while. And for me it was like, finished EuroLeague, how to get the guys back, because for them it was a difficult blow, there's no question.
But okay, in summer, how that brainstorming process looks like?
Also, you know, a lot of rest in the summer, a lot of mosquitoes in Milan. Huh? a lot of rest in the summer, first of all. I mean, we did end up playing 90 games last year, you know, the club record, I think even European record. Not just 90 games between EuroLeague and ACB, which is a lot of games in ACB is like EuroLeague. And, you know, you need rest first. Then second part of the season, we already start thinking about how we're going to do it. And, you know, there's restrictions of pretty much how you can start the season. So it's not like you need to do one thing, like you need to think, you know, rethink things. Then you start building your system again, you know, from the beginning, offensively, defensively, trying to understand what you have now, because we did change four players. And actually we changed five players. We brought in new four players, and, you know, it starts the grind from zero, basically. And every year you have to figure stuff out. So rest is basic, you know, the most important, not to drive yourself crazy, not to drive family around you crazy, and your team, you know, not to drive them crazy.
Can you compare the beginning of the training camp last year when you have this new team, when you started your head coaching career here in Barca, and the training camp, the first days of the training camp this year? What mentality differences you noticed from the beginning?
Everything was more or less the same. It just helps you that majority of the players, they know you, they know what to expect. It's much easier to put in defensive schemes, offensive schemes. They know what you expect of them, so it's a little bit easier. You know, every year it seems like we have less and less preparation, and it drives, you know, physical preparation coach a little bit crazy, but the players have their association, they agree with the EuroLeague. You have to respect in a way, you know, we started probably 3 or 4 days later than the year before, you know, and basically, again, I think 2 months we had rest, it's more than enough, and start grinding.
What did you see in the eyes of veterans like Kalates, Nikola Mirotic, the way they changed during the last season, for example? Maybe there was a turning point when they kind of started, you know, fully believe in your system, and you felt that you have all the team on the same page.
Yeah, I think around the new year, you know, we were starting playing. We had very good November, I remember, last year, and then around New Year's in January, we started clicking. You know, it was a lot of, more or less it happens around that time, you know, around January. Hopefully, maybe if you have a team, maybe you can start playing better a little bit in December. Just basically figure out what you have, who fits better with who fits, I don't know, starting, coming off the bench, one type of matchup defensively against a certain type of players, and the other guy. Against the other type of players, what we need to hide defensively, in a way offensively, what we need to hide, you know. So, like I said, it's constant process, and this is my huge emphasis, you know. Just every year you start from the zero, basically. So,
but I mean, all these star players had to make a lot of sacrifices, right?
Yeah.
Because, for example, Mirotic was always a top scorer. Kalates was the main guy in Panathinaikos.
Exactly.
We have Higgins, a lot of other players. So did that situation require any some personal attention to these players, some personal discussions with them, private discussions?
Not so much personal discussions at the beginning, as much as a lot of video watching as a team, trying to understand this is good shot, this is bad shot. Try to understand what is team game. You know, you're not gonna score 20 points every game, but you know, if you have a better matchup, if one guy is really playing well that night, I mean, we have to ride this guy that evening, and we have to come again the next day to understand stuff is from zero, and it's okay to be left at 8 points, something. It doesn't mean that you had a bad game. There's so many other ways to contribute. Find a way to contribute, you know. I mean, you could be having extra rebounds. Maybe you need to have crazy energy on defensive end. I mean, you just have to be solid. You have to play good. It doesn't mean that if you scored 20, you played good. And I think in that's what the winning players understand, you know, exactly what you said. I think the players like Nick Kalathis coming from other team, Mirotic, you know, being with different coaches, you know, they understood this with time, you know, and that's why, you know, we had success last year.
Was it hard to explain Nikola what is a bad shot, what is a good shot? The way he makes the shot, it seems like every shot is good for them.
I think the players deep down, they understand everything. Honestly, I believe they understand everything, unless they're clueless. Then we don't want them on our team and things like that. But usually at this level, players are very smart. They understand what you're asking for them. I mean, sometimes maybe they disagree with you, but in general terms, I think they like to be pushed. I think they like to be coached. I think they want to improve. This is the reason why they got to the level of one of the top teams in Europe. And you know, sometimes it's not easy to have a conflict or to discuss things, but ultimately it's for the best. And I think deep down players understand that, and they want to be coached, you know.
I believe you had to challenge all these players the last season, I mean, to be on the same page and stuff like that. I was just thinking, did they try to challenge you in some way, just to check some, you know, lines between you?
Well, they always check. I think every every team this is happening. I think they always see what the limits are, you know. And then if as a coach you don't say anything for them, like, you know, but I mean, you must try to tell them this is not the way we want to play defense. This is not the way attitude in this sense. This is not the way to fire just at every opportunity, because we have other, you know, 7-8 very good players who are also waiting their line. So I mean, this is the point a little bit, and you know, some fights occur during the course of the season. Like I said, ultimately it's for the bigger goal. It's for the goal of the team to achieve things, to get yourself more chances of winning the games. And yeah, I mean, as a coach, you have to fight for it. You have to fight for what you believe in.
One of your additions this summer was Rokas Jokubaitis, who is one of the best young players in the EuroLeague. And in Lithuania, it was a hot topic about Rokas Jokubaitis, whether he should go to Barca or he should stay in Zalgiris, because now maybe people in Lithuania think that he gave away, you know, a solid role in Zalgiris and stuff like that. How did you like his transition so far in Barcelona? Transition to a new culture, a different country, and especially such a high-level team like Barcelona.
Well, he's gonna fit in. He's a very easygoing guy. He's gonna fit in. I think as far as the team goes, I told him before he comes that he will play at every opportunity that we can. You know, we really want to build the program here. We want to develop. You know, young guys and have them in our system for a while, so they get identified with the club, they get identified with the city, and he's one of the best young players in EuroLeague. So we are very happy to have him. As far as you know, his play, we have to be realistic. He's 28-year-old. He's 20-year-old who's giving us things already, but he's still a 20-year-old. So we have to be patient with him. We have to understand that he is going to be up and downs. And you know, I cannot ask the same from Jokubaitis that I ask from Laprovittola and from Kalathis, who at the peak of their careers.
What is your vision for Jokubaitis, for example, in a three-year project?
I mean, in three-year projects, I hope he will turn out to be one of the best point guards in Europe at this point, you know, and that is already, in 3 years, will be a finished product. Then this is my idea, you know. Yeah. There's always the idea of the player himself and his agent and his people around that not always is in the same line with club, but, you know, this is life, and when this point will happen, we will deal with it.
Talking about Barcelona, what it's like to be the head coach of Barcelona, to be a fan of Barcelona, when the whole organization is going through tough times, right? We see that they're having debts, their football team is losing games, Lionel Messi gone and stuff like that. What it's like to be part of Barcelona right now?
Well,
is it challenging?
You're talking about the football things mainly, you know. I mean, it's challenging in a sense that, you know, in my first year over there, I didn't have a president for 6 or 7 months. You cannot have decisions. You cannot sign players, basically, when this is happening. You cannot spend 1 euro without, you know, 1 euro leaving. So you feel a little bit alone, you know, and everything is improvisation. Then the president comes, they have to do the audits of the bank accounts and what they have money, and you want to start, you know, come May, let's say, or June, and have very clear vision how much you can spend or how much you can do, and you ended up not knowing it. So the whole summer was a big improvisation, but, you know, this is the situation, this is the cards we have, and you have to play with those cards, and we were trying to improvise all through the summer with the new bosses, and we understand that we are a football club first, so they have to be solve their issues, their situation, and, you know, try to do your best. Basically, try to do your best to work for the club.
Yeah, there were reports about some players disagreeing to reduce their salaries and stuff like that, and that's the worst part of your job, probably, because it's not in your control, you know, the way, what kind of player you're gonna receive in the practice, if he will be, you know, pissed off by somebody else, what is going on off the court.
In this conversation, you know, we did have conversation with some players as far as try to keep your head in the job. So yes, I do understand that the club is in bad situation. Nobody put a gun to your head to sign this contract. But this is a situation that arose and you have responsibilities for the team and I'm responsible for the basketball part. So it's important for me that, like you said, like you are present here in practices, that you are giving 100% and we're improving as a team. So you try to separate the business part and the basketball part. And I don't know. And, you know, the most important at this point is if we're improving, if we're getting better and if we're gearing up for the second part of the season.
Talking about the bigger picture, what do you think about the recent news in the EuroLeague about Jordi Bartomeu dismissal next summer?
I think, you know, I think this is more maybe a question for the owners. There's obviously they haven't been happy with the EuroLeague developments, and you know, me personally, I was always a fan of EuroLeague. I'm also a fan of the new format of the EuroLeague. But if the, you know, there's also, like we said, the business part, there's many departments and we need to see if the departments are working for each EuroLeague team. And if it's not, obviously, like everywhere in life, there's changes to be made. So I look at it as normal ways to get better, you know. And I think the clubs, they voted for change, for getting better. So this is the direction we are heading right now. But I like the idea of this EuroLeague. I like the idea of the model. I like the idea of playing, you know, 34 games and everybody go to the gym of other team, and through the year the fans of, I don't know, of Munich or Tel Aviv or somebody, they get to see all the teams, and this is great for me.
What's unused potential do you see in the EuroLeague? And for example, if there was something like a coaching board which would influence the EuroLeague to make some decisions, what you would suggest, you know, changing, improving, upgrading?
I think over the years, we as coaches who created association, we really complained that we haven't been let in a lot of decision makings during the pandemic times and all of that. It seems like they are passing us on the side a little bit. And this is another, you know, complaint from us coaches. We constantly complain for the EuroLeague that we were never heard of. You know, we were never heard in certain situations, or last ones to be heard. And this is maybe the problem of the EuroLeague. That's why changes are coming. Maybe not everybody feels like they are heard. I don't know. But as far as the coaching association and the EuroLeague head coaching board, we felt like we were not heard in many situations.
One of the main candidates, even probably the main candidate to replace Jordi Bartomeu as of right now, is Paulius Motiejūnas, your good friend, your former colleague in Žalgiris Kaunas. Do you believe he can be the guy who could lead the EuroLeague, or what qualities he has to be that main
like
guy?
Like I said, you know, I'm already getting way in over my head, you know. I mean, I'm a basketball coach, used to be a basketball player. It's difficult for me to have opinions, you know. I think the guys who go through the meetings all the time, and they should be the ones who decide. There's a business part of the EuroLeague that is huge for them. Obviously, you know, our salaries, they come from those departments, and this is very important. So, but you know, if you don't grow, basically you stay back. This is what they say about every line of the work and everything. So EuroLeague has to grow. If it doesn't grow, that means we're going backwards.
There are some rumors about NBA coming in Europe. Do you see any sense how NBA could, you know, influence European basketball, how they could help us realistically?
No, I don't see it, honestly. I think they can only if they improve the business model, maybe, that is working for them really over there in States, that'd be great. But you know, as far as mentality wise, it's a whole different ball game here. It's you know, it's that's the beauty of this EuroLeague. I mean, You look at an NBA game with so relaxed atmosphere, you know, that a lot of times, you know, here every game is a dogfight. You know, you're looking at every game like a, you know, huge fight, huge suffering, and you know, huge effort. So I like it. I'm not a fan of taking games off, and I believe in the professionalism of every day, and this is what European basketball is all about.
But do you agree that EuroLeague, you mentioned 90 games per season, it's like the NBA calendar. Do you believe that EuroLeague especially with the regular season format, is getting closer to the NBA. And now it's different how we should approach the regular season. Like, we shouldn't lose our heads after seven games, for example, or we shouldn't, you know, overhype the start of the season.
I think, you know, like I said, it's very important for me to understand if we are improving the record at this point in Barcelona. Like I said, we have a great record, but my question is always is, are we really improving? Are we gearing up to get better? But as far as just passing time by, I think it's not the right. I think it's bad thing about the NBA. You know how easy they are in some games. And you know, having been in NBA, I think it's not quite that they are throwing the games away. Mm. You know, I don't agree with that notion that regular season NBA don't matter. No, teams do play hard. Teams do play to win. You know, but it's just, I don't know. It's just a lot of games, and I think still the championship teams still have the same qualities. They still compete every night or most of the nights. I mean, this is usually it's very few miracles. Then if you just trick off basically the regular season, you're gonna be fine in the playoffs. No. Usually it doesn't work like this over the time. You know, the top teams are still the top teams in the regular season still.
And for you as a head coach, is it hard to keep the focus of your players during the regular season? The EuroLeague, for example, we had a great example of Efes last season. They were 11th seed after seven games, and then they became champions. And yeah, but it seems like some teams like CSKA, Efes, who more or less know that they're about the final four teams.
Yeah,
you know?
But you have to analyze each case. Why Efes was so bad at the beginning of the year last year? They had some injuries. Mm. You know, Shane was not there. Then took time to get going. CSKA right now losing games. They have injury problems. You know, so the healthy teams maybe have a little bit of advantage. But the question is, like, are they getting better? Because from second part of the season, Efes was constantly getting better. I believe Barcelona was constantly getting better last year. So those are the teams that came to the finals. Then we ended up winning our leagues, you know. So the question is, are we getting better? To be at this point 7-1, 6-2, 5-3. Maybe it's the bad schedule. Maybe it's a lot of injuries. Maybe you play all your games on the road, something like this. But the question is, how are we acting? Are we building something? Are we heading in the right direction? So those are the questions that more important than 7-1, 8-0, whatever, 5-3. That's what I said. Even in Zalgiris, I said that I'm not looking so much in the standings until January. You know, the process is what counts.
What do you think about Zalgiris' current situation? All these changes they made so fast.
I think it's so difficult for the organization like Zalgiris to be always in the level of the playoffs. Things are a little bit logical. They clearly in the rebuilding phase. I don't know. Like I said in one interview, it was a little bit surprising for me that they went, let's say, from black to white, from white to black. As far as when we left for Barcelona, it was from the level of philosophy, ideology, whatever you want to discuss, it was too big of a change. I think those are usually not really the ones that give good results. And, you know, then you have...
Do you mean the way they were playing or building their roster?
Everything. Everything. Just you change philosophy completely. You go to American philosophy from European philosophy. I'm not sure that, you know, always... You see the NBA in a lot of ways. They changed the basketball over the years gradually. It became a lot like European game now. It's so much three-point shots, so much open court, and the guards go not so much post up over there because the court is so big. But, you know, at the end, ultimately, we have to play with our cards. I mean, we have to adjust to our players. I mean, they are the main weapons. So if we have this type of team, we have to use this player. Then players change, players leave. Again, we have to adjust and to put players in the situations to succeed. This is the most important about our job.
Yeah, it seems like they are getting back to that, let's say, old school European basketball, right? With hiring coach Jordi.
Listen, you know, I don't really... The worst thing is that a lot of times in those situations as an outsider, you're just guessing why things are being done. You know, you have an opinion, but you don't really, this is what drives us crazy who are on or inside, you just don't know. Yes, I understand, you know, there's journalism, there's fans, and you make opinions and something, but, you know, you have to know why things are being done, and probably this is why the transparency is very important. You know, a lot of times in Zalgiris cases, you see Paulus coming out and explaining his decisions, because obviously he has to, it's the team of the city, the team of the country. And, you know, so we have to understand why they're doing things like they're doing. But it's not easy, I'm telling you. It's not easy for the team with the one of the lowest budgets that didn't have fan support for a year and a half to be competing with the top teams with a huge budget. You have to hit all the right buttons.
Mm. And in Lithuania, there's a huge topic, whether Žalgiris should, let's say, give the season away in order to build up for the next year, or they should still try to keep, you know,
I think you should never give anything away. I think you should fight for every win. This is the mentality. This is the DNA of Žalgiris. The fans, if they come and after 0-8, they see the team fighting, playing good basketball, they will get right back behind the team. I mean, you know how the fans of Žalgiris are, and they will come, they will fill the arena, they will enjoy. They will enjoy a little bit, you know, this fighting spirit that the team must have, the identity of the Žalgiris, the identity of Kaunas, you know, a hard-nosed, hard-working city. So, no way. In my opinion, no way you should throw away games, you should throw away the season. But like you said, it's also, you need to have a plan. You need to have a plan. Again, we don't know the mentality, but I've seen the list of the players that Žalgiris has as an option, and the list is, at this point of the season, it's not that great. What, I can tell you that.
It's based on low Žalgiris budget, dry market, or?
I think combination of everything.
Hmm.
I think combination of everything.
In this situation, I mean, you showed a good example of signing hungry players, unproven players in the EuroLeague, and hoping that they will succeed in Žalgiris. Žalgiris tried the other way, buying, let's say, solid, matured, veteran players with EuroLeague experience. What do you think, what's the better way for the low-budget team? We have not only Žalgiris, but also Zvezda, you know, Aspel, some other
There is
clubs.
No better way. Because I signed young players, up-and-coming players, I mean, that means there was no veteran players on the list that they presented me. I mean, I wanted veteran players. You know, you need less time with them. But if the player that is not on the list that Paulus is presenting me, that the agents are sending me, then there is no player. So, I mean, we signed at some point, you know, Beno Udrich coming from the NBA, you know, Tupan was already coming from somewhere else, you know, from G League. And we signed some veteran players. Don't forget, we had a lot of veteran Lithuanians at that point. Jankūnas, Milaknis, you know, these were veteran players. When I became a coach, we had Kalnietis, you know, who left for Milano at that point. So, say, Butis, we had veteran players. So it was also a little bit, you know, the combination, have a mix, you know, it's like a little bit like a puzzle.
Going to the end, how do you feel watching your good friend Zeljko back in European basketball and running Partizan Project?
I feel happy. I'm just feel bad for his assistant that cannot take out the marker. You know, I send a message for him, you know, like, don't get the guy nervous. He's just a marker, you know.
Something was wrong in the suit, probably.
Exactly. No, you know, I spoke with him a lot. He's very happy over there. This is his club. This is his love, you know, and I think he's very happy. I don't miss his games. I think I also love the team that he has, because it's a lot of talented young players together with, you know, Punter and Zach over there, that they give some veteran leadership and some Serbian guys. And it's going to be nice to see how they develop. I think there's a lot of potential for that place if they continue in that direction.
Can you imagine yourself in Zeljko's situation? I mean, okay, going back to your, let's say, dream team, Žalgiris Kaunas, way of fighting in Euro Cup and stuff like that. Can you imagine yourself? Because it, for me, tells a lot about his passion for the game.
Yeah,
for
his just roots. He just wants to be happy. You know, he just wants to be happy. He's in Belgrade, at his home. He's with his team. He has very intriguing team. He has a very clear goal to bring Partizan to EuroLeague. I think he's happy. I think at this point, what else? You already won everything. You did everything in your life. What he just needs to be happy. I'm 100% sure he's happy.
Last week, you had your 100th victory in the EuroLeague, and you already mentioned how important, how beautiful for you is to win games. Did you meet any other person who was also so obsessed or even more obsessed in winning when you, for example? Did you meet a bigger winner than you?
Yeah, a lot of my teammates were obsessed. A lot of my coaches were obsessed. Like I said, Zeljko is, you know, crazy about situation. I mean, I can put a lot of things, you know, Anthony Parker, Diamantidis, Panulis, you know, these guys are, you know, these guys are killers, man. They would do anything to win. That's why I was so lucky to play with them, to be in the same locker room, to learn certain situations. Itudis, you know, also it's that breed, you know, like it's like no, you know, this is why you need to consider yourself fortunate to be working with the people like this, because this is a team game. You cannot do anything alone, you know. You just need to be surrounded by the good front office, by good players, by good fans. It's like one more time, it's like a puzzle.
And as being so obsessed winner, okay, you won the Copa del Rey last year, Spanish championship. You didn't manage to win the EuroLeague, but you were one win away from that. How do you feel after that kind of season, as being that kind of winner? Are you pleased? Are you happy? Do you understand that it's a part of the process?
First of all, we cannot change it now already, so we have to look back and be proud of what we did. We're proud that we grew, that we became closer as a team, again, in the process, but, you know, here we go. We start from zero again. Every game is from zero, you know. So every season is from zero, but really from zero, zero, zero.
Sarunas Jasikevicius, ladies and gentlemen. thanks for your time, and follow us on basketnews.com.